The service on Boxing Day was held in St Leonard's Church. So the service you're about to hear is the Watchnight Service, which took place in Hope Park and Martyrs Church, starting at 11:30 on the 24th of December. It was shared with all the local Church of Scotland churches in the St Andrew's cluster.
Leave the dark and cold of a St Andrew's night and gather in this sanctuary and prepare to be confronted by the light, the true light, the light that shines in the darkness, the light, God's light, that can never be put out. Leave the hassle and worries of your life in the world for a time and gather with others, each with their own story, each with their own hopes and concerns. And together, let's take time to pause and be still. Take time to reflect. Take time to know peace, deep peace, God's peace. This year, in the run-up to Christmas, many of us will have been staying at home more than normal. Maybe we're further ahead than usual. Maybe some small things still to do. So leave the wrapping of presents and the loose ends that have still to be seen to, and take time simply to focus on the thing that is ultimately most important right now. We join together in this church to celebrate again that special moment when God came to earth in human form, a tiny baby, full of life, yet small and vulnerable, full of promise and potential, but then as yet unrealized. We gather to hear the familiar story and sing familiar songs and worship the baby, Jesus, who will become the Saviour of the world, the light of the world, the Prince of Peace. Welcome, whether you attend church each week or only high days and holidays, or whether this is your first time at worship, it's good to see you. I'm pleased to be sharing the worship with Graham Beebe, who's minister at St Leonard's, and Marion Payton, who's locum at Holy Trinity, the first of three cluster services the Church of Scotland churches in the town and the outlying villages. So no that you are very welcome indeed. You can see burning brightly the four purple Advent candles, and then later, we're not trying to hit midnight exactly, but later as we near the end of the hymn, Silent Night, Holy Night, the lights in the church will be dimmed, and we'll take a time of silence to reflect on the meaning of Christ's birth, and then I will light the Christmas candle to mark the arrival of Christmas Day. At the end of our worship, there is a retiring offering, which this year goes to a local charity, to Families First. You will see details of our forthcoming joint services printed on the white sheet. Have you got a white sheet as well? Yeah, you'll see all the details there of tomorrow's Christmas Day services and other cluster services. When the service is concluded, we'll all leave by the main entrance and we'll leave by the back to the front. But if you just follow the indication of the stewards, that would be a great help. And you're reminded that hand sanitizer is available at the door as you leave. We pause for a moment to gather our thoughts and draw near to God before our first hymn. We sing the first one in the carol sheet, O Little Town of Bethlehem.
Thank you.
Let us pray. We have gathered together to meet you in this place, to be reminded of how your incarnation story started to be unfolded to us. So in our awe and wonder, we ask you to accept our worship. Loving God, these days we seem to be surrounded by so much worry and fear. The Omicron variant, insufficient data to date to draw firm conclusions, rising COVID numbers. On this night of all nights, and this season of all seasons, guard us against unnecessary worry and fear. Cutting through the dark, cutting through into the world, the appearance of an angel produced fear in the surprised shepherds. But the angel quickly offers these reassuring words: do not be afraid. Cutting through the dark, cutting through the noise of animals, cutting through into the world, a tiny baby ushers in a new way, a way of love, light, peace, a way free of fear. So where we are hesitant to believe, forgive us and make us confident in faith. Where we neglect to remember you, forgive us and remind us of your constant presence. Where we are fearful, forgive us and release us from that fear. May the light that enters the world through the birth of Jesus enlighten our path, burn in our hearts, and influence our actions as we do our best to serve you faithfully in our lives day by day. Hear our prayers through the Prince of Peace, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Our first reading comes from the prophecy of Micah at chapter 5, beginning to read at verse 2. But from you, Bethlehem in Ephrathah, small as you are among Judah's clans, from you will come a king for me over Israel, one whose origins are far back in the past, in ancient times. Therefore, only until she who is pregnant has given birth will he give up Israel, and then those of the people that survive will rejoin their brethren. He will rise up to lead them in the strength of the Lord, in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God. They will enjoy security, for then his greatness will reach to the ends of the earth. Then there will be peace. Thanks be to God.
And for our second reading, we turn to the Gospel according to Luke, and to chapter 2, reading verses 1 to 14. And there we read. In those days, a decree was issued by the Emperor Augustus for a census to be taken throughout the Roman world. This was the first registration of its kind. and it took place when Quirinius was governor of Syria. Everyone made his way to his own town to be registered. Joseph went up to Judea from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to register in the city of David, called Bethlehem, because he was of the house of David by descent. And with him went Mary, his betrothed, who was expecting her child. While they were there, the time came for her to have her baby, and she gave birth to a son, her firstborn. She wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. Now, in this same district, there were shepherds out in the fields, keeping watch through the night over their flock. Suddenly, an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone round them. They were terrified, but the angel said, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news, news of great joy for the whole nation. Today, there has been born to you in the city of David a deliverer, the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger." All at once there was with the angel a great company of the heavenly host, singing praises to God. "Glory to God in highest heaven, and on earth, peace to all in whom he delights." For this word of God in Scripture, as for the word of God that is among us and within us. Thanks be to God. Amen.
We sing number 20, "On Christmas Night All Christians Sing."
When the ministers in the town discussed this service together, one of the questions asked was, "What do you normally wear for the watchnight service?" My reply was, a cassock and tinsel. There was a short sort of surprised silence and a short pause. And then the discussion continued. Of course, it has to be said that tinsel is quite appropriate for Christmas, for there is a time when eyes sparkle with eager anticipation. Houses are lit up with coloured lights, trees are decorated, and even the streets are brightly lit and sparkly. Indeed, everything in the area is sparkling with anticipation. But this is also a time when we who are the church, the body of Christ in the world of today, should be sparkling with eager anticipation as we await the moment when we mark the birth of the Saviour once again. Hence the tinsel. But we do have to be careful with tinsel, because so many in the world of today think that the tinsel is the most important thing about Christmas. If you look around the shops at present, it is the decorations, the food, the gifts, all the commercial hype, and dare I say, the economic gain that Christmas affords, that seem to take center stage in the Christmas celebrations. So whilst it is fun to have all these things, we must remember that they are not the reason for the season. And we also must remember that so many cannot afford these things, and that there are so many others who will not have them because of lonely circumstance. And we should do what we can to help. Then there's tradition. Everyone seems to have their own Christmas traditions, things they have enjoyed for many years, traditions without which Christmas would simply not be right for them. Last Christmas, we were starved of so many of these traditions because of the restrictions for our safety. And as I write, we are still not sure what restrictions will have been placed upon us by the time we get to this time. So many people felt that Christmas last year was dry and arid because we could not share in the music of the season. And there were so many families who could not be together, so many people who could not visit as they would have wished, so much that was missing about the celebrations. For many people, a large part of their Christmas tradition is hearing again the well-loved stories that we have already heard this evening. They are so important to our celebrations. But if they are only stories that we like to hear at this time of year, then sadly, they are not worth very much. So we see that tradition is important, but it's not the reason for the season. When I was growing up, our family would come home from the midnight service, and my father would read again the opening words of the Gospel of St. John before we went to bed. It was a family tradition, and although I'm the only one left, I still do it before I go to bed on this night. But it was far more than that for us, for I guess we all fell asleep pondering the divine mystery of the Word made flesh. So Alan is going to read it again for us now.
In the beginning, the Word already was. The Word was in God's presence, and what God was, the Word was. He was with God at the beginning, and through him all things came to be. Without him, no created thing came into being. In him was life, and that life was the light of mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has never mastered it. There appeared a man named John. He was sent from God and came as a witness to testify to the light, so that through him all might become believers. He was not himself the light. He came to bear witness to the light. The true light, which gives light to everyone, was even then coming into the world. He was in the world, but the world, though it owed its being to him, did not recognize him. He came to his own, and his own people would not accept him. But to all who did accept him, to those who put their trust in him, he gave the right to become children of God, born not of human stock, by the physical desire of a human father, but of God. So the Word became flesh. He made his home among us, and we saw his glory, such glory as befits the Father's only Son, full of grace and truth.
Here is the wonder and mystery of the words of the prologue to the Gospel of St. John. And here is that profound truth that is at the center of our faith. Christmas is not, in the first instance, about tinsel and parties and children with sparkling eyes, lovely though these things may be. Nor is it about family traditions, however important they may be. The wonder is that Christmas is about the God of eternity breaking into the world of time. Christmas is about that profound mystery which tells us that at a particular time, in a particular place, God chose to come to us himself in the form that we could understand. It is about the fact that he came to us as a little child. At some time during that period when Quirinius was governor of Syria, in a little town called Bethlehem, a child was born who, beyond the power of any human being to understand, was the Creator God, who humbled himself to come into the world as a helpless baby, to live our life, to share our death, and to defeat sin and death for us. Whenever that birth took place, and we cannot be entirely sure when that was, the God of eternity humbled himself in love and came to live in the world of time. It was the turning point in the whole of human history. The one who none can look upon and live was delivered into a stable under the soft, indifferent gaze of the cattle to be one of us. Or to put another slant on the events of that first Christmas, with the birth of Mary's child, the Father of all mercies put himself at the mercy of humanity. In the words of St. John, at this time, the Word became flesh. He made his home among us, and we saw his glory, such glory as befitted the Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. Let us pray. O sweet child of Bethlehem, grant that we may share with all our hearts in the profound mystery of Christmas. Pour into our hearts the peace for which we sometimes search so desperately and that only you can give. Help us to know one another better and to live as sisters and brothers, children of the same Father. Awaken within us true love and gratitude for all your goodness towards us. Grant us your peace and join all your people together as one family, living together in the peace and light of your love. Amen.
We're going to sing number 13. Then the lights will dim and we'll take a time of silence before then I move to light the Christmas candle. Silent night, holy night, number 13.
Thank you.
"It is very good that the day has arrived that God's love is made human, that the Prince of Peace is born. May we make room in our hearts for him, and may we spread peace and light and justice and joy. May I wish you all a peaceful and joyful Christmas. As the lights go up, please let us take time to look around, and since we're not able to share in the usual way, let's just mark the arrival of Christmas Day with a round of applause."
Let us pray. A moment ago, Lord, we shared the words from John's Gospel. Those words we know so well, that we hear so often at this time of year. "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. In him was life, and the life was the light of mankind. And the light that shines in the darkness, and which the darkness can never overcome." But Lord, the truth is that we're not altogether convinced that darkness is a thing of the past. There are too many people whose world is one of shadows, and pressures can crowd in upon us all and get us all down. There are lots of reasons. Loss, illness, worries about family, uncertainties about the future, fears around the virus, around drugs, drink, boredom, doubt, weariness. And then there's the world itself. So much of the news revolves around war and poverty, climate change, disease. Lord, sometimes it seems as if the list is endless. And yet tonight, we are reminded that you are with us in our troubles, that you know us, and you love us, always. Tonight, we are reminded that in Jesus, you came not to a perfect world, but to a broken world, to bring light to its darkness, to bring light to our darkness. And so we pray for our world, for a world in need, and we pray for its people, for a people in need. In need not just of a technical fix, but in need of love and grace, of forgiveness and hope, of peace and fellowship, in need of renewal. God, in need of you. We pray that you would come alongside us and all those for whom we pray tonight, and that you would help us to see the light, to see the one who came and who still comes, to set us free, to give us life, to bring health and peace. And hear us as in a moment of silence. We pray for those who find themselves enveloped in darkness of whatever kind. People we have perhaps thought about in this past week, situations that we remember from this past year. Families such as those, the charity that we will collect for tonight, Families First, seek to help in our own community, in our own area. Hear us as we pray for these, that they may see and know the light of Christ this night. Hear our prayers, O Lord, spoken and unspoken, and answer them for Jesus' sake. May it be so, Lord. In Christ's name, let it be so. Amen.
Know you're welcome at all the forthcoming services. Our closing hymn, number 12, O Come All Ye Faithful.
Come all ye faithful.
May the joy of the angels, the humility of the shepherds, and the peace of the Christ child be God's gift to you and all people this Christmas and always. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you all now and evermore. Amen.